وقد يستغرب الواحد منكم كيف نتكلم عن العلم، علم الله عز وجل بالمقدر، فهذا أمر اتفق عليه المسلمون، فنقول قد كان في المعتزلة من ينكر هذا ويقولون إن الله عز وجل لا يعلم بالمقدر حتى يقع، وهذا قول القدرية من المعتزلة، لأنهم يرون أن العبد يتصرف في فعله كيف شاء ثم يعلمه الله عز وجل بعد أن يقع فيكتبه إن كان حسنة حسنة وإن كان سيئة فسيئة، وهذا باطل من أبطل الباطل، فإن الأمر المقدر لا يمكن أن يقع دون علم الله عز وجل، تعالى الله عز وجل عن ذلك. ومعنى هذا أن إرادة العبد غلبت إرادة الله عز وجل فوقع في ملك الله عز وجل ما لا يعلم، وهذا كفر. ولهذا قال الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى، يقول عن هذا الصنف من الناس يخاطب تلاميذه، يقول ناظروهم بالعلم، فإن أقروا به أقروا بإثبات العلم لله عز وجل بالمقدر فقد خصموا، خلاص يعني انهزموا في المناظرة، وإن أنكروه فقد كفروا. وكما أن الله عز وجل قال إن الله بكل شيء عليم، فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في صحيح مسلم من حديث عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص رضي الله عنهما قال: قدر الله مقادير الخلائق قبل أن يخلق السماوات والأرض بخمسين ألف سنة وكان عرشه على الماء. فالله عز وجل قد قدر المقادير كلها قبل أن يخلق السماوات والأرض بخمسين ألف سنة، فكيف يقال إنه يقع في ملك الله عز وجل ما لا يعلمه ثم يعلمه الله عز وجل بعد أن يقع؟ تعالى الله عن ذلك علوا كبيرا.
So the first point on these levels of within of pre-decree is the point of Allah's knowledge. Allah knows everything. So some of us may find it surprising that this needs to be mentioned, and they may think, you know, why does it need to be mentioned? Allah knows everything. Isn't this something which we all know already? Well, the point is that some of the Mu'tazila, in fact the Qadariyya, the deniers of Allah's pre-decree from the Mu'tazila, they denied this point. They denied the point that Allah has always known everything. And they say that a person creates his own actions, he does as he wishes himself. And Allah does not know what he's going to do until he had actually done it. So if he does an action of disobedience to Allah, Allah did not know what he was going to do until after he's done it. And so his will, it's as if his will has got the better of Allah's will. He's done something which Allah didn't want him to do. He's got the better of Allah's will. And this is a saying, this saying of theirs, that as we said, it means that their will has got the better of Allah's will. And this is a saying of unbelief. This is incorrect, cannot happen, and it is a saying of unbelief, kufr. And Imam al-Shafi'i, when he spoke to some of his students about these people, and he advised his students, debate with them, when these are the ones who deny Allah's pre-decree, all of Allah's pre-decree. So debate with them about the point of Allah's knowledge. This first point of it, debate with them about that point, about Allah's knowledge. And if they agree upon Allah's knowledge, Allah has always known everything, then you have defeated them in argument. In other words, they've got no further argument left. And if they deny that point, then they have committed kufr, they have committed unbelief by denying Allah's knowledge. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith reported by a Muslim from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As that Allah pre-decreed the decrees of the creation 50,000 years before he created the heavens and the earth, and his throne was upon the water. So 50,000 years before Allah created anything, he'd already pre-decreed it, what would occur. He knew and pre-decreed it.
وعلى الضد من ذلك نجد الجبرية وهم جهمية الذين يقولون إن العبد مجبور على فعله، ولذلك سموا بالجبرية. يقولون إن العبد مجبور على فعله لا اختيار له في فعله، واستدلوا لذلك بأمور. الأول حديث ابن مسعود الذي في الصحيحين أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: يجمع أحدكم يجمع خلق أحدكم في بطن أمه 40 يوما نطفة، ثم 40 يوما مثل ذلك علقة، ثم 40 يوما، ثم 40 يوما مضغة، ثم يأتيه الملك فينفخ فيه الروح ويكتب شقي أو سعيد، ويكتب رزقه وأجله. فقالوا هذا معناه أن الأمر قد قدر عليه أنه إما شقي وإما سعيد. وكذلك ما جاء من حديث علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما كان مع الصحابة وهم يدفنون أحد الموتى فجلس وجلس الصحابة حوله، ثم قال في جملة من حديثه الطويل المشهور، قال: ما من نفس منفوسة إلا وقد كتب موضعها من الجنة والنار. فقالوا هذا يدل على أن الإنسان قد فرغ من موضعه، أهو من أهل الجنة أم من أهل النار. قالوا ويدل أيضا على هذا قوله تعالى: وما رميت إذ رميت ولكن الله رمى، يعني عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة بدر، هذه الآية من سورة الأنفال: وما رميت إذ رميت ولكن الله رمى. وأيضا يستدلون بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لن يدخل الجنة أحد بعمله. قالوا: ولا أنت يا رسول الله؟ قال: ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله عز وجل برحمة منه. هذه شبه الجبرية التي تعلق بها في أن العبد مجبور على فعله، لا اختيار له في ذلك ولا إرادة. ونقول هذا الكلام باطل. صحيح أن المقادير قد قدرت وأن العبد قد كتب موضعه من الجنة أو النار، ولكن ما يدريك أنك من أهل النار أو من أهل الجنة، لا تدري. ولذلك كما قال العلماء: القدر سر الله لا يعلم حتى يقع. فأنت لا تدري ماذا سيقع بعد 5 دقائق، لكن إذا وقعت علمت أن هذا كان مقدرا، فهو سر من أسرار الله عز وجل. فأنت تعمل على أنك من أهل إيش؟ السعادة، وعلى أنك من أهل الجنة. وينبغي أن تعلم أنك إذا عملت بعمل أهل السعادة وفقت إلى هذا العمل ويسر لك ذلك، وأنك على العكس من ذلك إذا سعيت في عمل أهل الضلالة هديت إلى الضلالة والعياذ بالله. وجماع ذلك قوله تعالى: فأما من أعطى واتقى وصدق بالحسنى فسنيسره للحسنى. إذن هؤلاء عملوا الأمور التي توجب أن تجعلهم من أهل السعادة، وأما من بخل واستغنى وكذب بالحسنى فسنيسره للعسرى. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى: فلما زاغوا أزاغ الله قلوبهم. فالله عز وجل ما أزاغ قلوبهم ابتداء إلا أنهم زاغوا عن أمر الله عز وجل. هذا شيء. الأمر الآخر، نقول إن الله عز وجل خلق فيك إرادة تامة وقدرة جازمة، بحيث أنك تختار الفعل الذي تريد أن تفعله، بل تختار حتى الهداية، وتختار حتى طريق الجنة وطريق النار. فالله عز وجل جعل لك إرادة ومشيئة وقدرة تامة تختار بها الفعل. إذن كيف يقال أنك مجبور على فعلك؟ يقول الله عز وجل: لمن شاء منكم أن يستقيم. فإذا أثبت الله عز وجل للمخلوق مشيئة يختار بها الاستقامة من عدمها. وكذلك قال الله تبارك وتعالى: منكم من يريد الدنيا ومنكم من يريد الآخرة. فأثبت للمخلوق إرادة يختار بها الدنيا أو يختار بها الآخرة. طيب، أما قوله تعالى: وما رميت إذ رميت ولكن الله رمى، فهذا الدليل لنا لا علينا، لأن الله عز وجل أثبت لنبيه رميا: وما رميت إذ رميت ولكن الله رمى، لكن الله عز وجل جعل تسديد الرمي ممن؟ من الله عز وجل. لكن الرمي حقيقة وقع ممن؟ من الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، لكن إصابة الرمي والتوفيق من الله عز وجل. أما قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لن يدخل أحد الجنة بعمله، قال ولا أنت يا رسول، قال ولا أنا، فإن الباء هنا ليست للسببية، ليس معناها لن يدخل أحد الجنة بسبب عمله، والباء هنا عوض، باء العوض، يعني لن يدخل أحد الجنة عوضا عن عمله، فيأتي يوم القيامة يوم على الله عز وجل ويقول يا رب ادخلني الجنة عوضا عن أعمالي الصالحة التي عملتها، فإن أعماله الصالحة لولا تيسير الله وتوفيقه لها ما كان له أن يعملها، وهي لا تساوي بعض الأنعام التي أنعم الله بها عليه. فإذا لا يدخل أحد الجنة بعمله، المراد بالباء هنا باء الإيش؟ العوض، وليس معناه نفي الإيش؟ السبب، بدليل أن الله عز وجل أثبت الجنة والجزاء في آيات أخرى بسبب الأعمال، ادخلوا الجنة بما كنتم تعملون، واضح كثير من الآيات فيها إثبات دخول الجنة بسبب الأعمال. طيب،
and the opposite to these people the deniers of the Qadr, in opposition to them, direct opposition at the opposite end of the scale, is the Jabariyya, who are the Jahmiyya, the ones who say that the servant is forced to do whatever he does, he has no choice, he is totally forced to do whatever he does, having no free will at all. And these people, they seek to use various evidences for what they say. Amongst them is the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, reported by Bukhari and Muslim, that the creation of each one of you is brought about 40 days, it brought about in the belly of his mother for 40 days as a clot, a spot of blood, and for 40 days as a clot of blood, and for 40 days as gathered flesh. And then the angel comes to him and writes down for him whether he will be from the unfortunate ones or from the fortunate ones, and writes down his life period for him. So these things are already written for him. So these things are already written for him, whether he will be successful or unfortunate, people of the hellfire or paradise, it's already written at that stage. So he's got no choice. Secondly, they use as an evidence the hadith of Ali radiallahu anhu, the long hadith when they were burying one of the companions and they sat around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told them, there is no soul who breathes except it has already been written for him his place in the paradise or in the hellfire. So they say, therefore he's got no choice again, it's already written for him. Whether it be a person of the hellfire or paradise, it's something written and finished. Thirdly, they use an evidence from Surah Al-Anfal, the ayah, where it is mentioned where Allah addressed his prophet and saying, with the meaning that you did not throw what you threw the dust, but it was Allah who threw. So they say, so therefore, Allah affirmed the act of throwing himself. So he was the one who did the, it was Allah who did the throwing. He did not affirm the action for his servant, he affirmed it for himself. So he is the doer of the action. And fourthly, they say, they quote the hadith, that nobody will enter paradise, nobody will enter the paradise due to his actions. So the companion said, and not even you, O Messenger of Allah. So he said, not even me, unless Allah covers me with his mercy. So they say, so therefore, actions are not, this is not because of actions you enter paradise, rather it is just whether you are decreed to go into paradise or hellfire. So it's something you were forced and have no choice about. So this saying of theirs, and the way in which they use the proofs, is futile and wrong. The fact that these things are pre-decreed is correct. And the fact that the places of the people in the paradise and the hellfire is correct. But none of us know where which place we are going to, from the paradise or the hellfire. We don't know. We don't know if we are written in as people of the paradise or written as people of the hellfire. So nowhere are we forced to do the actions of one or the other. And we don't even know what's going to happen in 5 minutes' time to us. So how can we say that because it's been written about where we are going, that we're forced to do whatever we do? It doesn't follow at all. And this is why some of the Salaf said that the pre-decree is Allah's secret. It is a secret matter which Allah's kept secret. Nobody knows it until it happens. So the fact that the things have been pre-decreed is not a proof that we're forced to do what we do. Because we don't know what has been written. So in no way can we be forced, therefore, by something we don't know. And likewise, if a person acts and he does the actions of the people of paradise, if he is acting and he is acting and doing the good actions and the actions which lead to paradise, he must realize that is by Allah's grant of success to him. Allah has granted him that and made him do those actions of the people of paradise. And opposite to that, a person should realize if he is doing the actions of the people of the hellfire and leading towards hellfire, that is because that is what Allah has written for him and made easy for him. When the ayah was quoted, and with regard to those who give in charity, and they fear, as they act upon fear of their Lord, and they give credit to the truth, then Allah will make that which is al-yusra'in
tasir.
Allah will make the way to paradise, meaning that which is good and that which leads to paradise, Allah will make that easy for him. So those who do the good actions, Allah will make easy for him. For them, the way to paradise, and they do the good actions which lead to paradise. And then the ayah which follows, that those who act in a miserly manner, and in acting according to evil deeds, then Allah will make easy for him the way to the way which leads to the hellfire. So those people who do the actions of the people of the hellfire, Allah will make that easy for them, so they act in accordance to the actions of the people of the hellfire and lead to the hellfire. And the ayah was mentioned as well, that those with the meaning that those who deviate, then Allah causes their hearts to deviate. So it was mentioned that first of all they deviate themselves, so Allah increases their deviation. They themselves chose to deviate. And we know for certain, and there is no doubt, that in each person Allah created certain will in each person, and he created ability and power in each person. So a person with this will and with this ability and power may choose what he wants to do. And he can even choose, he can choose the way to paradise and to take that way, and he can choose the way to hellfire and he can choose to take that way. And in the ayah was mentioned, لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَسْتَقِيمُ, for those amongst you who wish to act in a good manner, in a straight manner. So Allah mentioned for those of you who wish and will. So Allah affirmed that people have wish and they have will. They do have free will. And then the next ayah was mentioned, with the meaning that amongst you there are some who desire this world and there are some who desire the hereafter. So Allah affirmed that people have desire, have will for this world, and there are some who have will and desire for the hereafter. Again, Allah affirms free will for them. And with regard to the ayah which they seek to use, and with the meaning that, and you did not throw, but Allah threw, that is a proof for us, the people of the Sunnah, against the innovators. Because Allah affirmed when you threw, with the meaning that when you threw, he affirmed that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam threw. And he mentioned him as a doer of that action of throwing. So that was the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the meaning of Allah that Allah formed this ayah was merely that he did it, he did the throne by the grant of Allah, by Allah's grant of success, that he should be able to do that. Allah granted that he should throw, so he could throw. And the it was accomplished. His accomplishment was again a grant by Allah. That is what the ayah affirms. And it does not deny that the people do not, the people do their own actions. And with regard to the hadith, that no one will enter the paradise, but then with regard to the actions, this word, the beef in it, what it does not mean is, it doesn't mean nobody will enter paradise because of or due to his actions. It doesn't mean that. Rather, what it means is that the actions which a person does, they themselves are not his, you know, the person's actions are done again by, because Allah has granted you the ability and the power and the success to do that. And it's Allah's grant, He has granted you that power to do the action. And again, no matter how many your actions are, they will never match up to the favours which Allah has placed upon you. So you will never have automatic right to enter paradise, because you will never, no matter how many actions you have, they will never match up to Allah's favours upon you. But the actions are a reason. They are a reason for entering paradise. As is shown by many proofs, that the reward for the actions is paradise. And then the ayah was mentioned, where it was said with the meaning, enter paradise according to that which you used to do. According to that which you used to do. So actions are a reason for entering into paradise.
وهؤلاء الجبرية إذا قيل لهم لما فعلتم هذا المنكر قالوا قد كتبه الله علينا، لكنهم لا يقبلون مثل ذلك فيما يعاملهم به الخلق، فلو أتيت إلى أحدهم وضربته أو سرقت ماله وقال لك لما فعلت ذلك، قال كتبه الله، قلت له قد كتبه الله عليك، ما قبل ذلك منك، ويدل على تناقضهم. ويذكر بعض العلماء عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه أنه أتي برجل قد سرق، فقال له ما حملك على ذلك يا أمير المؤمنين؟ فقال له أمير المؤمنين ما حملك على ذلك؟ قال قد كتبه الله عليه. فقال له أمير المؤمنين قد كتب الله أن نقطع يدك. طيب، هذه الحجة، الاحتجاج بالقدر على المعاصي، حجة من؟ حجة المشركين. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى سيقول الذين أشركوا لو شاء الله ما أشركنا ولا آباؤنا ولا حرمنا من شيء. فماذا كان جواب الله عز وجل لهذه الشبهة؟ كذلك كذب الذين من قبلهم. فسمى الله عز وجل شبهتهم كذبا.
The Jabariyah, the ones who say we have no choice, everything we do is just forced upon us, when they do evil actions, then they'll say, when they're doing an evil action, if you ask them, why do you do this? They'll say, because Allah wrote it. Allah pre-decreed we should do it, we have no choice. So they use Allah's pre-decree as an excuse for their own evil actions. But the same excuse, they won't accept it from you. If you went to one of them and hit him, you thanked him one, you steal from him, and then he wants to know from you, why have you stolen from me, why have you punished me? And you said, because Allah decreed it, he will never accept it from you as an excuse. They won't accept it. So it shows that they themselves are self-repeating argument. They contradict themselves, self-contradictory. And some scholars mention in relation to Umar radiallahu anhu, that a man came to him, a man had stolen in his time. And so he came before Umar. And so he passed the judgment that his hand should be cut for stealing. So then the man, he thought of an excuse to avoid this. So he said, when I stole, I only stole because Allah pre-decreed that I should steal. Allah wrote that I should steal and pre-decreed it. So it happened, I couldn't help it. So then Umar radiallahu anhu gave the order and said, yes, Allah pre-decreed that you should steal, and he pre-decreed that you should cut your hand as well. And this This is the excuse, this excuse of pre-decree that people use for their sins, and when they're asked about why they're committing this sin, they say Allah has decreed this. This is the excuse of the mashriks, of the idol worshippers. And then the ayah was mentioned with the meaning that those who do shirk, the people of shirk, they say, if Allah had not willed, we would not have committed shirk. Nor our fathers, if Allah had not willed it, we wouldn't have done it. But then Allah responded in the same ayah. Likewise did those before them lie. Likewise was the lie of those before them. They said the same lie. So this is a lie. They're not committing their sins, and they're not committing their shirk because Allah pre-decreed it. They did it by their own choice and their own will. So Allah declares their plea and their excuse as a lie, as kadhib.
ويقولون أن الإيمان قول وعمل ومعرفة يزيد بالطاعة وينقص بالمعصية من كثر طاعته أزيد إيمانا ممن هو دونه في الطاعة ويقولون إن الإيمان قول وعمل والإسلام فعل ما فرض على الإنسان أن يفعله إذا ذكر كل اسم على حدته مضموما إلى الآخر فقيل المؤمنون والمسلمون جميعا مفردين أريد بأحدهما معنى لم يرد بالآخر وإن ذكر أحد الاسمين شمل الكل وعمهم وكثير منهم قالوا الإسلام والإيمان واحد قال الله عز وجل ومن يبتغي غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه فلو أن الإيمان غيره لم يقبل وقال فأخرجنا من كان فيها من المؤمنين فما وجدنا فيها غير بيت من المسلمين ومنهم من ذهب إلى أن الإسلام مختص بالاستسلام لله والخضوع له والانقياد لحكمه فيما هو مؤمن به كما قال قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم وقال يمنون عليك أن أسلموا قل لا تمنوا علي إسلامكم بل الله يمن عليكم أن هداكم الإيمان وهذا أيضا دليل لمن قال هما واحد. هذه العقيدة الآن في الإيمان. والإيمان ينبغي أن نعرف أنه اعتقاد بالقلب ونطق باللسان وعمل بالجوارح. أما الاعتقاد بالقلب فهذا واضح من حديث جبريل عليه السلام لما ذكر الإسلام والإيمان، قال الإيمان أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره. فالإيمان عقيدة في القلب أيضا، الحب في الله والبغض في الله، والإيمان بالغيب والإيمان بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وما يكون في اليوم الآخر والأخبار التي جاءت عن اليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره، هذا كله من الإيمان الذي يكون في القلب أيضا. ويكون أيضا الإيمان لا يتم أيضا إلا بالنطق أيضا باللسان، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الإيمان 64 شعبة أعلاها قول لا إله إلا الله. فقول لا إله إلا الله إذن من إيش؟ من الإيمان، بل هو من أعلى شعب الإيمان. وأدناها إماطة الأذى عن الطريق، وإماطة الأذى عن الطريق من الأفعال. إذن يطلق الإيمان أيضا على الأفعال والأعمال. ولذلك قال الله تبارك وتعالى في شأن الصحابة الذين ماتوا وقد استقبلوا بيت المقدس ثم أمروا بالتحول إلى الكعبة، فقال عز وجل في شأن هؤلاء وما كان الله ليضيع إيمانكم، فسمى صلاتهم واستقبالهم القبلة إلى بيت المقدس في الأول الإسلام سماه إيمانا. فإذا الإيمان اعتقاد بالجنان ونطق باللسان وعمل بالأركان. والإيمان عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة أن الإيمان يزيد وينقص، والأدلة على ذلك كثيرة جدا. وأن القول أن الإيمان لا يزيد فهذا هو قول المرجئة، يقول الله تبارك وتعالى: إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا. صريح الآية في زيادة الإيمان. إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى: وإذا ما أنزلت سورة فمنهم من يقول أيكم زادته هذه إيمانا. فأما الذين آمنوا فزادتهم إيمانا وهم يستبشرون. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى: الذين قال لهم الناس إن الناس قد جمعوا لكم فاخشوهم فزادهم إيمانا وقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. فزادتهم إيمانا صريحة في ثبوت زيادة الإيمان. وإذا ثبتت الزيادة يقول الحافظ بن حجر في فتح الباري: ثبت النقصان. وقد جاء أيضا إثبات النقصان كما في الصحيحين في قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ما رأيت من ناقصات عقل ودين عن النساء. كذلك أعلاها في قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث أبي هريرة الذي في الصحيحين: الإيمان 64 شعبة أعلاها قول لا إله إلا الله وأدناها إماطة الأذى عن الطريق. فهذا يدل على إيش؟ أن الإيمان يزيد وينقص ويتفاضل، وأن هناك شيء أعلى وشيء أدنى، وأنه يعني إذا لم يكن عند الإنسان هذه الشعب فإنه ليس وراء ذلك حبة خردل من إيمان.
The author mentions, and they say that Iman is saying an action and knowing. It increases with obedience and decreases with disobedience or sin. And whoever's obedience increases, it was plentiful, then he is more complete in Iman than not one who is less in obedience. And many of them say that Iman is saying an action, and Islam is doing what has been made obligatory upon a person that he should do. So if each one of them is mentioned individually, then it goes along with that, it goes along and is connected to the other. So if it is said the believers and the Muslims together or singly, if they are reported together, then each one of them has a different meaning. But if they are reported separately, if they are reported separately when one of them occurs, then each meaning, the meaning of that covers the both of them. And many of them say Islam and Iman are one and the same, because Allah the Mighty and Majestic says, and I was quoted, that whoever desires a religion other than Islam, it will not be accepted from him. Because if Iman was something different to Islam, then it would not be accepted. And he said, and I was quoted with the meaning, and we took out of it those who were in it from the believers, and we did not find in it except one house of the Muslims. And from them there are some who hold that Islam is particular to mean the submission to Allah, and to submit to Him, and to submit to His judgments in that which He believes. As He said, and the ayah was quoted, with the meaning, and the Bedouins say, the desert Arabs say, we have Iman. Say, you do not have Iman, rather you should say, we have entered into Islam, but Iman has not entered into your hearts. And he said, and I was quoted with the meaning, that they quoted as a blessing, they quoted as a favour to you that you have entered into Islam. So do not quote it as a favour, do not quote your entry into Islam as a favour. Rather, Allah has granted a blessing upon you that He has guided you to Iman. And this is also a proof for the ones who say both of them are the same. Islam and Iman are one and the same thing. So here the author is talking about Iman, the true and correct faith. And this is, the definition of Iman is belief of the heart and speech of the tongue and action with the limbs. And the proof of the first of these belief of the heart is the hadith of Jibreel, where he mentioned the things which are necessary for Iman, matters of belief, belief in Allah and His angels and His books and His messengers. So all these are matters of belief, so they are essential for Iman. And also the other things, such as love for Allah and His messenger, and hatred of the unbelievers, and belief in the matters of the unseen, and belief in the hereafter, and belief in the pre-decree. All these are matters of the unseen and the matters of the heart. And secondly, speech of the tongue, the proof that speech of the tongue is a part of Iman, is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Islam, that Iman rather, is 60 odd branches. The highest of them is the declaration that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. And the lowest of them is removing harm from the path. So the saying, that the declaration of the tongue, that Allah is, that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, this is the saying of the tongue. So this is described as the highest branch of Iman. So this is a proof that sayings of the tongue are a part of Iman. And the final one, the proof that actions are a part of Iman, was the ayah with regard, the ayah which was sent down with regard to those companions who prayed towards Jerusalem. They prayed at the start of Islam towards the direction of Jerusalem, and some of them died before the Qibla had changed to Mecca. So the only prayers they had ever prayed were towards Jerusalem. So some of the companions later, when the Qibla was changed, they worried and were concerned. What about those ones who died after praying only to Jerusalem? Will their prayers be accepted? So the ayah was sent down. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. That Allah will not waste your Iman. And the ayah means that Allah will not cause their prayers to be wasted. So Allah described their prayers, which are actions of the body, as Iman. So this is a proof that actions such as the prayer are a part of Iman. And this is the saying of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And also, a further saying of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah with regard to Iman is that it increases and it decreases. And those who deny this and say that Iman does not increase and decrease, they are the Murji'ah. But there are many proofs indeed that Iman does increase. And amongst them was the ayah, the first ayah that was quoted with regard to the believers, with the meaning that when the believers, when Allah is mentioned, then their hearts tremble. And when his signs or when his ayahs are recited to them, it increases them in Iman, and they depend upon their Lord. So he clearly mentioned Iman increasing when Allah's signs are rehearsed to them. And then the second ayah, when it was mentioned that the unbelievers say, who of you has this increased in Iman, with the meaning that those who have Iman, then they have been increased in that Iman by it. So again, Iman, increase of Iman was clearly mentioned. And then the next ayah, when it was said to the people, with the meaning, when it was said to the people that the people have gathered, so you had better fear them. And with regard to those who believe, it only increased them in Iman. Again, increase of Iman is mentioned. So there's a clear proof that Iman increases. And Ibn Hajar, Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar mentions, as soon as it is affirmed that Iman can increase, that is an automatic proof that it can decrease. As soon as something is something can increase, it can automatically, it must be able to decrease. And a direct textual proof of the decrease of iman is the hadith reported by Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet ﷺ described the women as being deficient in their intellect and in their religion. So they're being deficiency in it. And also the hadith which we mentioned, that iman is of 60 odd branches, and the highest of them is the statement that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and the least of them is removing something harmful from the path. So therefore there are different levels of it, and modesty is a branch of iman. So iman is many branches, therefore it's many levels. If a branch is missing, it is a deficiency in iman.
أما الفرق بين الإسلام والإيمان فنقول إذا أطلق أحدهما قصد به الآخر أو ضم المعنى الآخر. فإذا إذا أطلق الإسلام فهذا يقتضي أيضا أنه يحمل معنى الإيمان، أو إذا أطلق الإيمان فهو شامل للإسلام أيضا. لكن إذا عطف الإسلام والإيمان فهناك فرق بين الإسلام والإيمان، فإن العطف يقتضي المغايرة، كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات. والذي يدل على أن الإسلام غير عن الإيمان حديث جبريل عليه السلام الذي في الصحيحين، فذكر الإسلام والإيمان والإحسان. فالإسلام شيء والإيمان شيء والإحسان شيء. الإسلام أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأن تقيم الصلاة، وأن تؤتي الزكاة، وأن تصوم رمضان، وأن تحج البيت إن استطعت إليه سبيلا. فإذا الإسلام يكون إيش؟ للأعمال الظاهرة. والإيمان قال أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله، يكون إيش؟ لأعمال القلب وعقيدته. ولذلك لما قالت الأعراب آمنا أنكر الله عز وجل عليهم قولهم هذا، وهذا من أعظم الأدلة على إيش؟ على إثبات المغايرة بين الإسلام والإيمان. قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا، لأنكم تقومون بأعمال الإسلام ظاهرة، ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبك. لكن حد الإيمان ما بعد دخل في القلب ورسخ في القلب، وهذا واضح في أن الإيمان غير عن الإسلام. وأوضح من هذا أيضا ما جاء في الصحيحين من حديث سعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أعطى رجالا ومنع رجلا، فقال سعد بن أبي وقاص: يا رسول الله، أعطيت رجالا ومنعت رجلا هو مؤمن؟ فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أو مسلم؟ فإذا ما رضي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لسعد بن أبي وقاص أن يصف الرجل بوصف الإيمان، فقال له: أو مسلم؟ فأعاد عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذلك. إذن واضح أنه هناك فرق بين الإسلام والإيمان. أما قوله تعالى في شأن لوط وقومه: فأخرجنا من كان فيها من المسلمين فما وجدنا فيها غير بيت من المؤمنين، فهذا لأن أهل بيت لوط عليه السلام متصفون بالإسلام والإيمان جميعا. نعم.
So then comes the point, the distinction and difference between Islam and Iman. And if the translation wasn't very clear, inshallah, this is what was meant, what's stated here is what was meant there, which was not very clear in the translation. The difference between Islam and Iman, so there's a principle that if one of them is mentioned on its own, just Iman is mentioned in some text, then it automatically covers the other one. So if Iman is mentioned, then it covers Islam. It covers whatever is in Iman and whatever is in Islam. And if Islam is mentioned on its own, then what is meant by that is Islam and Iman, both of them. But the difference comes when they're both mentioned together in the text. When they're both mentioned together, Islam and Iman, each of them has a particular meaning, separate from the other. An example of that was the ayah that was quoted. Indeed, with the meaning, indeed, the Muslim men and the Muslim women, and the believing men and the believing women. So there's a difference. It's not just a repetition. There's a difference between the Muslim and the mu'min. And when they're mentioned together, they have a separate meaning. And the strong proof of this as well is the hadith of Jibreel, reported by Bukhari and Muslim, where he asked what was Islam and what is Iman and what is Ihsan. And different answers were given to what is Islam, to what is Iman. With regard to Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Islam is that you bear witness that none has the right to worship except Allah, that I am the Messenger of Allah, and that you use the obligatory prayer, and you give zakat, and you fast the month of Ramadan, and you make hajj if you are able. So he explained, the Prophet explained Islam to mean the outer actions, whereas Iman, he explained to mean belief in Allah, and belief in his angels, and belief in the messengers, etc. So he explained Iman as being the matters of inner belief. So Islam as being the outer actions, and Iman as being the inner belief. And one of the strongest proofs that Islam and Iman are two different things is the ayah that was quoted before, where the desert Arabs say, "We are entered into Iman, we are people of Iman." So they were told, "Do not say that you are people of Iman, rather say we are Muslims, we have entered into Islam, because Iman has not yet entered into your hearts." This is a clear proof that they are not one and the same. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave charity to a large number of men, and he left out one man and didn't give him something. So Sa'ad asked about this and said, you left out this man, and he is a mu'min. You left him out and he is a believer, a mu'min. So the Prophet didn't accept this thing from him and said, oh, he is a Muslim. So again, so he showed that he wasn't pleased with what Sa'ad had said, that this man is a believer, a mu'min. So then Sa'ad said it again, but you left him out and he is a believer, a mu'min. So the Prophet again said, oh, he is a Muslim. So clearly showing there's a distinction and a difference between believer, mu'min, and a
the author mentions, and they say, the Quran is the speech of Allah, not created. And that however it is, whether it's the person, whether recited by the reciter, and with its wording, or whether it's memorized in the hearts, or recited with the tongues, or written in the mushaf, it is not created. And whoever says that the wording of the Quran is created, meaning the Quran, then he has said that the Quran itself is created. Rather, that last point, rather, whoever says that the wording of a person with the Quran, meaning the Quran, is created, then he has said that the Quran itself is created. So the first point we need to know is that Allah has, one of Allah's attributes is speech, and that we must affirm the attribute of speech for Allah. And the ayah was mentioned where it is said with the meaning, and Allah spoke directly to Musa. Allah spoke directly to Musa. And the second ayah with the meaning that when Musa came to his appointed place, and his Lord spoke to him. So we affirm speech for Allah. And the Quran is from the speech of Allah. And amongst the proofs was the ayah that was mentioned with the meaning that if one of the people of shirk come to you and seek protection, then grant them that so that they should hear the speech of Allah. Meaning they should hear the Quran. So that they should hear the speech of Allah. And as occurs in the authentic hadith, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and he was angry and upset that what the unbelievers had done, the way they treated him, he said, they have prevented me
أن أبلغ كلام الله أو كلام
منعوني أن أبلغ كلام الله أو كلام ربي.
He said, "They have prevented me from propagating the speech of my Lord or the speech of Allah." So the belief of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is that the speech of Allah is to be taken literally, that it is Allah's speech, and that Allah speaks with letters and with a voice. So the first of these, or the second of these, the proof that Allah speaks with a voice which is heard, from the proofs for this is the hadith reported by al-Bukhari, the hadith Qudsi, that on the day of resurrection Allah will speak and he will call out to Adam with a voice. Allah will call to Adam with a voice, "O Adam, take out from your offspring the ones who are due for the hellfire out of every 1,999 and we ask that Allah makes us from those whom he saves from the hellfire. And from the proofs that Allah speaks with letters is the hadith reported by Tirmidhi with an authentic chain of narration from Ibn Mas'ud that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Whoever recites a single letter from the book of Allah, then he has 10 rewards for it." And I do not say that Alif Lam Mim is a single letter, but rather Alif is a letter, Lam is a letter, and Mim is a letter. And the Jahmiyyah, the innovators, the Jahmiyyah, they came and they denied this, and they said instead, rather, the Quran is created, it's something created. And this is a saying of unbelief, a saying of kufr, because saying that Allah's speech is created is to say that Allah himself is created, which is unbelief. And the scholars from every time after then, they rejected this and agreed that this is a saying of unbelief, such as Imam Ahmad, Ad-Darimi, and Ali ibn al-Madini and others. They make clear that this is a saying of unbelief.
وأنه عز وجل ينزل إلى السماء الدنيا على ما صح به الخبر عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بلا اعتقاد كيف فيه. هنا أيضا يتحدث عن أسماء الله عز وجل وصفاته ويتكلم عن صفة خاصة من صفات الله عز وجل وهي صفة النزول. وهذه الصفة صفة النزول لله عز وجل ثابتة بالأحاديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، بل قد تواتر الخبر عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أحاديث النزول متواترة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولذلك أفردها العلماء بكتب خاصة كالإمام الدارقطني رحمه الله تعالى ألف كتابا خاصا في النزول جمع فيه كل روايات النزول، وشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله ألف كتابا خاصا في شرح حديث النزول مطبوع. وهذا الحديث متفق عليه وحديث متواتر له طرق كثيرة، أنه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: ينزل ربنا إلى السماء الدنيا حين يبقى ثلث الليل الآخر، يقول: من يدعوني أستجيب له، من يستغفرني فأغفر له. وهذا النزول نزول حقيقي يليق بجلال الله عز وجل، وأن الله عز وجل ينزل حقيقة إلى السماء الدنيا حين يبقى ثلث الليل الآخر. لكن أهل البدع ماذا قالوا؟ قالوا: هذا ليس نزول لله عز وجل، وإنما هو نزول لأمره أو رحمته. وهذا الكلام باطل، لأن تكملة الحديث ترد هذا التأويل، لأن الأمر أو الرحمة لا تقول: من يدعوني فأستجيب له، من يستغفرني فأغفر له، وإنما هو الله عز وجل الذي يقول: من يدعوني فأستجيب له، من يستغفرني فأغفر له.
The author mentions, "And he, the mighty and majestic, descends down to the lowest heaven, as is authentically reported from Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without any belief of how about that. So this is a point that we affirm Allah's descending, His Nuzul. We affirm that Allah descends. And the proofs of this is something established, and the proofs are very many of this. And the ahadith, the narrations from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are so many about this that they reach the level of mutawatir. They are huge in number. And there are so many that scholars have gathered them in whole books, written whole books, just on this one point of belief. Such as Imam Ad-Darqutni, he wrote a whole book on An-Nuzul, that Allah descends. And Ibn Taymiyyah likewise, he wrote an explanation of the hadith of Allah's descending, a whole book on that. And is affirmed in the authentic hadith that the Prophet ﷺ told us that our Lord descends when the one third of the night remains, and says, "Who will call upon me so that I may answer him? Who will ask for my forgiveness so that I may forgive him?" So we affirm that Allah descends, a true and real descending. But as for the people of innovation, then they deny this, and they explain it away, and they say rather, it is Allah's command that descends, or it is Allah's mercy that descends. But they refuse to affirm that Allah Himself descends. They say no, it's either His order or His mercy. And this is a futile saying of theirs. And the end of this hadith rejects this interpretation of theirs. Because Allah's mercy or Allah's order does not say, "Who will call upon me so that I may answer him? Who will ask for my forgiveness so that I may forgive him?" Rather, this is what Allah Himself says.
قال رحمه الله تعالى: ويعتقدون جواز الرؤية من العباد المتقين لله عز وجل في القيامة دون الدنيا، ووجوبها لمن جعل الله ذلك ثوابا له في الآخرة، كما قال: وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة. وقال في الكفار: كلا إنهم عن ربهم يومئذ لمحجوبون. فلو كان المؤمنون كلهم والكافرون كلهم لا يرونه كانوا جميعهم عنه محجوبين، وذلك من غير اعتقاد التجسيم في الله عز وجل ولا التحديد له، ولكن يرونه جل وعز بأعينهم على ما يشاء هو بلا كيف. هنا هذه مسألة الرؤية، والرؤية لابد أن نعرف أن الرؤية في الدنيا غير ممكن لأحد من الخلق أن يرى الله عز وجل في الدنيا. ولذلك لما سأل موسى عليه السلام ربه أن يراه، قال الله عز وجل: لن تراني، أي في الدنيا هذا ممتنع، غاية الامتناع. لكن الله عز وجل يمن على المؤمنين يوم القيامة ويرزقهم من القوة ما يستطيعون أن يروه، والدليل على ذلك قوله تعالى: وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة. والدليل الثاني أيضا قوله تعالى: كلا إنهم عن ربهم يومئذ لمحجوبون. هذه الآية في الكفار، يخبر الله عز وجل أنهم محجوبون يوم القيامة عن رؤية الله عز وجل، فمفهوم المخالفة أن المؤمنين غير محرومين عن رؤية الله تبارك وتعالى يوم القيامة. كذلك قال الله تبارك وتعالى: للذين أحسنوا الحسنى وزيادة. وخير ما يفسر به القرآن والحديث. وقد فسر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الزيادة كما في صحيح مسلم من حديث صهيب، قال: الزيادة هي النظر إلى وجه الله تبارك وتعالى يوم القيامة. وكما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: لهم ما يشاءون فيها ولدينا مزيد. قال ابن عباس: المزيد رؤية الله عز وجل يوم القيامة. أما أهل البدع فأنكروا الرؤية لله عز وجل في الدنيا وفي الآخرة، وقالوا: لأن الله عز وجل قال لموسى لما سأله أن يرى ربه: لن تراني، وقالوا: لن تفيد النفي المؤبد. وهذا غير صحيح، لن لا تفيد النفي المؤبد، بدليل كلام أهل اللغة أنفسهم، حيث قال ابن مالك رحمه الله: في منظومته الكافية الشافية قال: ومن رأى النفي بلا مؤبدا فقوله اردد وسواه فاعبدا. الأمر الثاني من القرآن يقول عز وجل عن الكفار في الدنيا: ولن يتمنوه أبدا، يعني ولن يتمنون الموت أبدا، لكنهم في يوم القيامة لأنهم في النار ماذا يقولون؟ ونادوا يا مالك ليقضي علينا ربك. فلو كانت لن في لغة العرب تفيد النفي المؤبد ما حصل أنهم يوم القيامة يقولون يا مالك ليقضي علينا ربك. أيضا قول مريم عليه السلام: لن أكلم اليوم إنسيا، لا يفيد النفي المؤبد للكلام، لكن تفيد أنها محدود بوقت معين. وأما استدلال أهل البدع بقوله تعالى: لا تدركه الأبصار، فلا دليل فيه، لأن الإدراك ليس بمرادف للرؤية، الإدراك قدر زائد على الرؤية، الإدراك يكون فيه رؤية مع إحاطة، وهذا منتف عن الله عز وجل، فإن الله عز وجل لا يحاط به كما قال الله عز وجل: ولا يحيطون به علما. لكن قد تحصل الرؤية من غير الإحاطة كما حصل لموسى عليه السلام ومن آمن معه لما هربوا وتبعهم فرعون وجنوده. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى: فلما تراءى الجمعان قال أصحاب موسى إنا لمدركون، قال موسى: كلا إن معي ربي سيهدين. فهنا حصلت الرؤية، أصحاب موسى يرون فرعون وجنوده، لكن ما حصل الإدراك، ما أدرك فرعون وجنوده موسى وقومه. أما جواب أهل البدع عن قوله تعالى: وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة، قالوا المراد هنا بالنظر الانتظار، وهذا أيضا تحريف، فإن النظر يأتي في القرآن على ثلاثة أوجه: يأتي معديا بنفسه كما في قوله تعالى: انظرونا نقتبس من نوركم، فهذا بمعنى الانتظار، وتأتي معدات بفي كما في قوله تعالى: أولم ينظروا في ملكوت السماوات والأرض، فهذا بمعنى التفكير والتأمل، ويأتي النظر معدى بإلى كما في قوله تعالى معنا في هذه الآية: وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة. فهنا النظر عدي بإلى وأضيف إلى الوجه الذي هو محل العينين الذي تحصل به الرؤية، واضح؟ وجاء الحديث الذي في الصحيحين: سترون ربكم لا تضامون في رؤيته، في زيادة عن البخاري: سترون ربكم عيانا يوم القيامة لا تضامون في رؤيته. نعم.
The author mentions, and they believe in the permissibility of the pious servants seeing Allah the mighty and majestic on the day of resurrection, not in this world. And that is something binding for those whom Allah has made it a reward in the hereafter, as he said, and the ayah was quoted, with the meaning that faces will be beaming on that day looking at their Lord. And he said about the unbelievers, and the ayah was quoted, and with the meaning that indeed they will be prevented from their Lord, prevented from seeing their Lord on that day. So if the believers, all of them, and all of the unbelievers could not see him, then all of them would be prevented from seeing him. And this is without any belief of giving a body to Allah the mighty and majestic, nor making any limit for him. Rather, they will see him the mighty and majestic with their eyes, just as he wills, without any question of how. So this point is with regard to seeing Allah in the hereafter. With regard to seeing Allah in this world, it is not possible.
And when Musa alayhi salam asked to see his Lord, Allah said to him, "Lan tarani," you will not see me, you can't see me. Meaning in this world, you can't see me in this world. But in the hereafter, Allah will give to the believers the strength to see him. And the proof was this ayah that was quoted, the first ayah, that they will look at their Lord, they will see their Lord. The ayah from Surah Al-Qiyamah. But the second ayah that was mentioned from Surah Al-Mutaffifin, that the unbelievers will be prevented from seeing their Lord. So it's a clear statement, the unbelievers will be stopped from seeing their Lord. So we directly understand from that the believers will not be prevented. They will be allowed to see their Lord. And a further proof was the ayah that was mentioned, that those who believe, for those who believe is a good reward and something extra, a ziyadah. So this word, and that which is extra, the best explanation of the Qur'an is the Qur'an itself and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this word here, this ayah we just mentioned, is hadith in Sahih Muslim that Suhaib said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the extra thing, the ziyadah, is looking at Allah on the day of resurrection. And then a further ayah where it is mentioned, وَلَدَيْنَا mazid, Allah mentions and there is something extra, some extra reward. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said this extra reward is that seeing Allah on the day of resurrection. But as regards to the people of innovation, then they deny that Allah will be seen in this world or in the hereafter. And they say that Allah can never be seen. And they say the word lan tarani, when Allah said to Musa, lan tarani, it means nobody can ever see me. And this is a wrong understanding. First, it's wrong in the Arabic language. Because Ibn Malik said in his book Al-Kafiyah Al-Shafiyah of the Arabic language, and whoever says, this is the rough meaning what he said, whoever says that lam means something can never happen, then his saying is rejected. His saying is wrong in the language. Secondly, Allah mentions in the Quran about the unbelievers, and he uses the word lam again, وَلَنْ يَتَمَنَّاهُ أَبَدًا, that they will never wish for death. The unbelievers will never wish for death. The Jews and the unbelievers will never wish for death. And yet in another ayah, it's mentioned that in the hellfire, that they will call on Malik, would that our Lord will destroy us. When they're in the hellfire, would that our Lord will destroy us, bring death to us. So it clearly shows that they will wish for death in the hellfire. So the meaning of the first ayah was, they will never wish for death in this life. And lam just refers to a certain period of time in this life. They will never wish for death in this life. But in the hellfire, in the next life, they will. And the ayah where was mentioned where Maryam said, I will never speak lam to a single person. Meaning on that particular day, not forevermore. So the word lam in the Arabic language means something will not happen for a certain period of time. And then afterwards it can happen. Then the unbelievers, they quote an ayah to say that Allah cannot be seen, that la tudrikuhu al-absar, that the vision cannot reach him. But there is a difference, or vision cannot comprehend him. But there is a difference here. There is a difference between seeing Allah and a vision comprehending him and reaching him. There's two different things. We affirm that the believers will see Allah, not that their vision will even comprehend him. And it was mentioned, a proof of this, that these are two different things, was the ayah that the Shaykh mentioned, that when Fir'aun and his army was chasing Musa and the believers, the people of Musa said, when the two armies were seen, that we have been caught, they've done idrak of us, they have caught us. So he mentioned they will not catch us. So the army of Fir'aun saw them with their eyes, but they did not catch and comprehend them. So seeing is one thing, but comprehending with the eyes and catching them is something else. And then thirdly, they take this ayah, the first ayah that was mentioned, that the eyes will be nadira, looking at their Lord, They say what that means, the people of innovation say it means they'll be waiting for their Lord. And this again is something false. The word another in the Quran occurs with three different meanings. First of all, I'll summarize this. First of all, it means waiting. Secondly, it means thinking. And then thirdly, and the sense here, because the sense here is different, where it said another ilah. When it's used in this sense with the word ilah, it means only looking and seeing. And the actual faces was mentioned as well, wujuhun. The faces looking. So it's clear when you have the word the wajh and the word nazar, it means nothing except seeing. They will see their Lord. And the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported by Bukhari and Muslim makes the matter very clear, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "You will indeed see your Lord. Do not doubt about seeing him." And the wording of al-Bukhari, "You will openly see your Lord. Do not doubt about seeing him." This leaves no doubt and is very clear.
If anybody has any questions now, open for questions. Concerning the first verse, when asked about the caste song getting beaten on the deathbed before, and the dunya gets beaten in the front and the back, give a reference of who is from the lead.
هذا ما تحدثنا عنه في الدرس، سؤال خاص هذا. يقول ما الدليل على أن الكفار يضربون حال احتضارهم، تضربهم الملائكة؟ الدليل قوله تعالى: ولو ترى إذ يتوفى الذين كفروا الملائكة يضربون وجوههم وأدبارهم. لكن الناس ما ترى، الملك ما ترى، يأتي ويضرب الكافر نسأل الله العافية على وجهه وعلى دبره والعياذ بالله، جزاء وفاق.
The question was about the unbelievers. When the angels come to take their souls, they'll strike the unbelievers on their fronts and on their backs before they take their souls. And the Sheikh mentioned the proof for this. He mentioned the ayah, where it's clearly stated that if you saw the angels when they come to take them, they'll strike them on their fronts and strike them on their backs.
أنا أسألكم. I will ask you. Okay. What is the دليل for the attributes of Allah? Close your notes and things. And your. Okay. Who knows? Raise his hand, please. So I want to count. Any who is, mashallah, taking care of the lecture. واحد اثنين ثلاثة. What is the proof for the attributes of Allah in the Quran and Sunnah? 1, 2, 3, 4. Who knows? Raise his hand. 4 out of 40. MashaAllah.
What is the proofs from the book and the Sunnah that Allah has attributes? Not particular attributes, just in general. Allah has attributes.
Just 4, 5, 6. Yeah, right here. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. طيب بعد what else؟
ولله المثل الأعلى.
ممتاز. ولله المثل الأعلى. What else؟ نعم. I love it because it has the صفة الرحمن. Okay, good. Now, يعني if one of the Ibn Hazm students come over, it's a little bit من عند السؤال؟ You have a question? Okay.
On the day of resurrection, can we ask about the past thoughts that come to our mind
يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله تجاوز لأمتي ما حدثت به أنفسها ما لم تعمل أو تتكلم.
The question was on the day of resurrection, will we be asked about the bad thoughts that come into our hearts So the Shaykh mentioned the answer. There was the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah has forgiven for my ummah
ما حدثت به أنفسها,
that which the suggestions which arise in their own selves, as long as they don't speak with it or act upon it.
الأسئلة الأولا للموضوع الدرس, الأسئلة الخارجية بعدين حتى ما يصير الموضوع.
So the first question should be about, you know, about a particular lesson that we had. Initial question should be about that, and then if there's any time left, if there's any questions outside the lesson, then.
Could you, some people argue that because the subject that you're dealing with is not anything you're possible with companions dealt with, but then you are innovating and you need to talk about these things, to talk about Allah's attributes in the way that you are, it's not anything specific from the Book of the Sunnah, but you are innovating.
Good question. At the time of the Prophet and the companions, there were no innovators. Okay? Then later on, also at the beginning of the time of Tabi'in, there were no innovators in this. Then by the end of the time of Tabi'in, then it stopped. Those people, Ja'd ibn Dirham was the first one, then Ja'd ibn Safwan, then Bishr al-Marisi, then it came through to the people making innovations in the attributes of Allah. This Ja'd ibn Dirham took his saying from who? From Aban ibn Sam'an. And Aban ibn Sam'an took it from Talut. And Talut took it from Labid ibn al-A'sam al-Yahudi, the one who made magic for the Prophet Sa'asim. So the origin of Ta'til, what is Ta'til?
Divesting Allah of his attributes.
Is Jewish. We wouldn't have been speaking about this and replying against the innovators if the things were as it is in the time of the companions and Tabi'in. So it's the nasiha, ad-din al-nasiha, it's nasiha for the Book of Allah and for the Sunnah, that we protect it from innovations and innovators. So if we don't do so, then bad aqidah will go through all the Muslims or most of the Muslims. Okay?
I get people, those who believe that Allah is everywhere, they come up with this argument from the Quran ayah, you know where Allah says it's closer to you than the devil of rain.
It's not in the Quran, it's in Sunnah. We'll talk about Ulu tomorrow, inshallah, because it's not in the book. Tell him, inshallah, tomorrow we'll talk about it in details.
Told you.
Yeah, tomorrow. But you should come tomorrow.
Yeah.
Once you have asked this question, you come tomorrow. If you don't come, we'll not answer it, okay?
No, inshallah.
That's time for prayer.
Thank you. It's too shy to ask you.
So, basically
about Janaba. Basically, you know the hadith for Ali that he had disease.
Medi.
No.
Not Janaba, Medi.
Medi. Basically, you're saying he ain't got disease or whatever, but I think what you're trying to say is because the fitna in the Western society today, and like it sometimes comes, does he have to make a ghusl? Did you have to make a ghusl?
For what?
Well, being in that state.
For what?
For Medi or Janaba or whatever.
Medi, there is no ghusl for Medi. Alaykum salam. Ayyakallah sayyid.
No.
Medi, just clean the place and didn't make wudu.
And the other one is saying, when he's with his wife, when he's with his wife, but the two private parts don't touch or whatever, but it still happens, does he have to make a ghusl then or?
They did not make love?
No.
But he made janaba?
But they're sitting together, like whatever.
They're sitting together without making sexual interaction, there is no ghusl. But if he made janaba by playing, this without sexual interaction, then there is ghusl, janabah. They make sexual interaction without without making the janabah, then they have to make ghusl as well.
What's the difference between madhi and janabah?
Madhi, janabah, madhi sometimes it's something that comes before janabah.
No.
Yeah, because of thinking of something or
no.
This and this. But janabah, when the whole body is getting this.
No. No, no, jazakallah khair.
Alaykum
assalam.
Assalamu
alaykum. And one more question. Concerning the salah, like the women when they pray, because the same brother, he's a Tory Mahadith about the women, the difference between the woman and the man, salah. And he's saying there's ikhtilaf about the women should have their feet covered or not. I'm saying, you know,
cover.
The Hadith says, I think the whole woman's up over that, apart from the face and the hands. They send the Hadith about, I think, when the wives should wear a long cloak, should her feet become covered within that.
She's at home? Okay. She's in front of others?
No. No. Inshallah. Jazakallah khair.
Yes, I need it. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. نسألهم قليلا قبل أن نبدأ الدرس نشوف كيف استوعبوا الموضوع. إذا قال لك المبتدع ينزل ربنا إلى السماء الدنيا أي ينزل أمره أو تنزل رحمته، فكيف ترد عليه؟
If an innovator says to you that with regard to the texts about our Lord descending, it means that Allah's mercy descends, His command descends. How do you reply to him? Asking the question, what is the reply to the innovator?
ما الدليل على إثبات صفة الكلام لله عز وجل؟
What is the proof for the affirmation of the attribute of speech for Allah? What is the proof for that?
This is in Surah Quran, from Quran. وكلم الله موسى تكليما. What else? ما في القرآن ما في بالمعنى ما في ما يصير القرآن تجيبه بالمعنى. ولما جاء موسى لميقاتنا وكلمه ربه. وإن أحد من المشركين استجارك فأجره حتى يسمع كلام الله ثم أبلغه مأمنة. طيب. قال رحمه الله تعالى ويقولون ما يقوله المسلمون بأسرهم ما شاء الله كان وما لا يشاء لا يكون، كما قال تعالى وما يشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله، ويقولون لا سبيل لأحد أن يخرج عن علم الله ولا أن يغلب فعله وإرادته مشيئة الله،
ولا أن يبدل علم الله، فإنه العالم لا يجهل ولا يسهو، والقادر لا يغلب. ويقولون إن الخير والشر والحلو والمر بقضاء من الله عز وجل، أمضاه وقدره، لا يملكون لأنفسهم ضرا ولا نفعا إلا ما شاء الله، وإنهم فقراء إلى الله عز وجل، لا غنى لهم عنه في كل وقت. هذا كلام الإمام رحمه الله الآن في مسألة القدر، وبدأ أولا بالكلام على صفة العلم، على المشيئة والعلم، ثم بعد ذلك يتكلم عن القدر خيره وشره. والإيمان بالقدر من أركان الإيمان، كما جاء في حديث جبريل الذي في الصحيحين، أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله والقدر خيره وشره. والمصنف رحمه الله بدأ بالمشيئة ثم العلم، يريد أن يتحدث عن مراتب القدر، وهي أربعة. يعني ما من شيء مخلوق، أو ما من شيء مقدر أو موجود، أو ما من حادثة تقع إلا وتمر بأربع مراحل قبل وقوعها، أو أربعة مراتب. المرتبة الأولى العلم، علم الله بهذا المقدر، وأن الله عز وجل قد علمه في الأزل. الأمر الثاني الكتابة، أن الله عز وجل كتب هذا الذي قدره ووقع، أو الذي قدره وسيقع مستقبلا. الأمر الثالث أن الله عز وجل شاء هذا الأمر المقدر. الأمر الرابع أن الله عز وجل خلق وأوجد هذا المقدر فوقع. وهذه المراتب الأربعة مجموعة في بيت من الشعر، يحسن لمن يعرف العربية يحفظه، فيجمع المراتب كلها في بيت واحد من الشعر، هي قول الشاعر: علم كتابة مولانا مشيئته، خلق وهو إيجاد وتكوين. أعيد: علم كتابة مولانا مشيئته، خلق وهو إيجاد وتكوين. المرتبة الأولى مرتبة العلم، أن الله علم هذا المقدر، كما قال الله عز وجل: إن الله بكل شيء عليم. وكما قال الله عز وجل: ألم ترى أن الله يعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض، إن ذلك في كتاب، إن ذلك على الله يسير. فهذه الآية جمعت المرتبتين، مرتبة العلم أولا ومرتبة الكتابة. ألم ترى أن الله يعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض، إن ذلك في كتاب. الأمر الثالث أن الله عز وجل شاء هذا المقدر، وما تشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله، إن الله كان عليما حكيما. الأمر الرابع الخلق، أن الله عز وجل خلق هذا الأمر الذي قدره، كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: وخلق كل شيء فقدره تقديرا. وكما قال الله تبارك وتعالى: إنا كل شيء خلقناه بقدر. فهذه مراتب القدر الأربعة، فما من أمر مقدر إلا وقد مر بهذه المراتب الأربعة كما بينا.
So the author mentions, and they say what all of the Muslims say: whatever Allah wishes is, and whatever He does not wish does not exist. As Allah the Most High says, and the ayah was quoted with the meaning, and that you will not wish except as Allah wishes. And they say, there is no way for anyone to go out from the knowledge of Allah, nor for anyone's actions and his will to get the better of the will of Allah, nor for him to change the knowledge of Allah, because the one having all the knowledge is not ignorant and does not forget,
And the one having all power cannot be overtaken or overpowered. And they say that all good and evil, all sweet and all bitter things are according to what Allah has decreed, He the Mighty and Majestic. That which is laid down, or ordained, and decreed. And they do not possess for themselves any harm or any benefit, except as Allah wills. So here the author is speaking about Qadr, Allah's pre-decree. And this is one of the points from the principles of Iman, the fundamentals of Iman, as shown in the hadith of Jibreel. Where it is mentioned that Iman is belief in Allah, belief in His angels, His books, His prophets, the last day, and in the Qadr, the pre-decree, the good and the evil of it. And the author starts by mentioning Allah's will and then mentioning the knowledge. And is indicating here the levels necessary in Allah's pre-decree. The four levels which we will mention here. And that everything which exists, everything which Allah creates, or which comes into existence or occurs, must pass through these four stages. These four things must pass through these four stages. The first of them being knowledge. Al-ilm. Meaning that Allah knew that. And Allah always knew that thing would exist. Secondly, that Allah wrote that. Allah wrote that thing would occur. The Kitabah. And thirdly, that Allah willed that this matter should occur. And fourthly, that Allah created it and brought it into being. And these four things are combined in a line of poetry which anybody who knows Arabic should memorize. And it was mentioned, knowledge and writing of our Lord and His will, the creation which is bringing it into existence and creating it. So the proof for the first of these four pillars of pre-decree, the knowledge, the ayah was mentioned where it was stated with the meaning that Allah knows everything. Allah knows everything. And the second ayah that was quoted with the meaning, do you not see that Allah knows everything in the heavens and in the earth, and that it is in a book? So this ayah also mentions the second level, the second degree of pre-decree, the one of writing. It is in a book. And then the third point of pre-decree, that Allah willed everything. Now I was mentioned where it was said that only and with the ayah with the meaning that you will not wish or you will not will except as Allah wills. And the fourth point, the creation, I was mentioned with the meaning where Allah stated that He created everything and pre-decreed it. And the other ayah that was quoted, that Allah said that He created everything according to a pre-decree. So everything which exists and comes in and occurs passes through these four levels of knowledge. Allah's knowing it, writing it, wishing it, and creating it.
وقد يستغرب الواحد منكم كيف نتكلم عن العلم علم الله عز وجل بالمقدر فهذا أمر اتفق عليه المسلمون فنقول قد كان في المعتزلة من ينكر هذا ويقولون إن الله عز وجل لا يعلم بالمقدر حتى يقع وهذا قول القدرية من المعتزلة لأنهم يرون أن العبد